Well, I'm Don Grace, the head of Thatcher Montessori School, and on behalf of the Board of Trustees of Thatcher, I'd like to welcome everyone to the third in our series of fall speakers. Last year and the year before, we've had fall speakers, and so happy to have David Sobel join that series tonight. So a few words of introduction about other folks here who've had a role in this, and there'll be an announcement, and then I'll introduce David shortly. So we're partnering with the Mary M. B. Wakefield Charitable Trust, and I'm happy to welcome Mark Smith. Mark, could you wave a hand there? Yeah, all right. Executive Director Mark Smith, and welcome. So Mark and I would like to together welcome you all. Could I ask for Mark's board and staff members to stand up to be recognized? All the Wakefield folks? All right, yeah. Want to also thank trustees and staff members who've helped out, Thatcher trustees and staff members. Could I ask for those trustees and staff members to stand for a round of applause, trustees and staff? And thanks particularly to Deborah Smith for all of her efforts coordinating things. So I want to do a quick acknowledgement of that there are a number of schools who have decided to attend this event, and also a number of environmental organizations, and appreciate the spreading the good word to those schools and environmental organizations and your presence here and the shared value you have for environmental education. So want to also thanks give thanks to Yoni. Yuri Lasorda, the principal of On the Dot Books in Dedham. Yuri, wave a hand back there, if you would. Yeah. Yuri, welcome. Yuri will have books on sale. And in fact, the very latest, the eighth and latest of David's books, debuting tonight. So this is the latest. Congratulations, David. And I'll walk right into this. Nature Preschools and Forest Kindergartens, the handbook for outdoor learning, not a handbook for outdoor learning. This is an audience of parents and educators, and we think that there's much for each of you in your different roles, and perhaps multiple roles for some of you as parents and as educators tonight. So environmental education is a core value for Thatcher. It's a core value that extends to Montessori as well. And we wanted to just emphasize that that is a shared core value with the Wakefield Charitable Trust. They're an organization that does environmental education for school children, is central to its mission. But is Lisa Christ in the audience? Very good. I'm going to call on Lisa Christ, our development coordinator, to actually announce an initiative that we unveiled today at Thatcher from a parent of an alum. Lisa. Thank
you. Good evening, everybody. It is a perfect night for this, and I am so pleased to announce the creation of the Ariel K. DaCosta Memorial Fund, thanks to a gift from the DaCosta family. And Ariel's father, Jim, is here tonight. I just want to give you a little bit of background. Ariel attended Thatcher Montessori School starting in 1994, and she stayed here through her upper elementary years. Her parents told us how much she loved it here and how active the family was in the community. They were here for the building of the gymnasium, and also they helped create the library that's here today. And if you look, there's a mosaic of tiles outside of the gymnasium, and Ariel has one on the lower left side of herself and her family dog. After Thatcher, Ariel went on to the Dana Hall School. She graduated from there in 2007 with honors. And then she went on to Georgetown to study comparative literature. And it's a very sad thing for me to tell you that she passed away unexpectedly in 2009. She was 20 years old and a junior in college. Ariel's family approached us earlier in the year to establish a memorial fund. And so when I started to gather information and ideas, I quickly learned that Ariel was a very lively, caring, and engaging person. She was very much loved by her family and friends. So we wanted to honor Ariel's spirit and passion by making the fund activities dynamic and meaningful to our students. We decided to focus the fund on environmental education for two reasons. One is because it is a core value here at Thatcher, and it's integrated into our curriculum. So we knew that it's something that would reach every student here. We also wanted to make sure that we incorporated Ariel's interests, and she was a great lover of animals, and so that was important to us. The fund will have three main activities. First, we will purchase library books for the school for use in classrooms and for use in personal reading that students can check out. And these, of course, will be nature and environment themed. The fund will also help cover expenses for field trips out into for environmental education and possibly programming for when we bring programs here on campus, such as the New England Aquarium's Traveling Touch Tank. And then finally, we'll create a community space in the library as a place for our community to share their experiences in nature. When I think of this, I kind of think of my kitchen windowsill, where my children collect items, found items, when we're out at the beach or when we're at the dog park, and the windowsill becomes that place where we put the branch with the perfect pine cone on the edge, or the really pretty sea glass, or the cool rocks, and it becomes a place that we can be reminded of our experiences and see these things. And so we'll invite classrooms throughout the year to share in the same kind of informal way. They can share items found on a nature walk over at Wakefield. They can share pictures from a trip that they've taken as a class. And it's a way for the community to continually connect and focus on nature. I'm excited about the opportunities that the fund will bring for Thatcher students, and I'm confident that Ariel's spirit and memory will live on through them. And I want to thank Jim and the DaCosta family for allowing Thatcher to be part of honoring your daughter. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Lisa, and thank you, Jim. So, an introduction of David, briefly. Noted author and speaker about environmental education. Teacher Magazine calls him one of the gurus and rock stars of environmental education. And in addition to that, he is a professor at Antioch College in New England, in Keene, New Hampshire, just right around the corner from where I grew up. David has lectured for a number of years on place-based education. And in that spirit, David, I just want to say I'm thrilled to be an Athol boy welcoming a keen guy to here in Milton. The title, Why 21st Century Children Need Nature. I'll tell one very quick story and then turn it right over to you. We'll have questions and answers at the end. I was on a wilderness trip in Washington, D.C., and was in charge, as the head of the school, I was in charge of the wilderness trips medications for kids who had all sorts of ailments that they were dealing with. And one child actually forgot his meds back in school. And I turned to the bus driver and said, you know, in a panic, we've got to turn around. This kid, this particular medication is really important to him. It was actually medication for ADD. And the bus driver said with real confidence, you know, I don't think he's going to need those meds. And in fact, he went without them. He just drove on. He wasn't going to turn around for me. And the kid just did fine, in part because the natural world had so much stimulation for him that he was able to focus his energies in ways that just were not happening in our schools and in that school. So that's not the only reason why we need nature, but I do look forward to hearing your talk, David, and to understanding as parents, as well as educators, how nature can play more of a role in our lives. Thank you, David.
Am I amplified? Yes, I am. So this is not the title that you thought you were coming to hear a talk on, and that's because I got here, spent time with the teachers, talked to folks over at the, you know, next door at Wakefield, and I realized that I thought that what I needed to talk about was different than what I intended to talk about. What I was going to talk about was going to be much more parenting stories, and what I think is more important is more of an emphasis on education and nature's role in education. And Don's example just now of the kid with ADD who does fine when he's outside is a recurrent finding in evaluation and research in lots of nature-based programs. So it's starting to become a clear pattern. A colleague of mine who works at a nature school in Washington State says, kids can't bounce off the walls if you take away the walls, right? I think we could turn down the mic, yeah. So that's one, for instance, of why we need to have the natural world and the surrounding cultural world be a part of, an integral part of schooling. Schooling has become indoorified too much of the time, and it's become academified, especially at the early childhood years where it shouldn't be academified. And so we've got to figure out the ways in which we make the walls of the school more permeable, so that they're being indoors and outdoors, you know, there's a much more of a flow, and that we're using the outdoors. And so I want to articulate why that's important. Now, I'm doing a different presentation, so I have a different PowerPoint than I thought I was going to use, and I had to mash it up a little bit, right? So I'm not quite sure what the sequence is. So if something's out of order, I'll just improvise. Here. Come on. Oh, it's not working. There we go. So I love this notion. Denying children of a chance to encounter nature, no matter small, robs them of the very essence of life. This is happening a lot. We are robbing kids of the essence of life because the world has become, children's worlds has become digitalized. And yet, concern over crime and children's safety is linked with the decreasing amount of time. So, a lot of us growing up in the 50s and the 60s, you know, your parents would say, you know, after breakfast, see you later, be home for dinner. And that's kind of rare nowadays, does not happen very much. And the world hasn't changed much, but we'll get to that in a second. I'm just gonna do this. So I love this quote from Luther Burbank, and I'm gonna read it. Every child should have mud pies, grasshoppers, water bugs, tadpoles, frogs, mud turtles, elderberries, wild strawberries, acorns, chestnuts, trees to climb, brooks to wade in, water lilies, woodchucks, bats, bees, butterflies, various animals to pet, hay fields, pine cones, rocks to roll, sand, snakes, huckleberries, and hornets. And any child who has been deprived of these has been deprived of the best part of his education. So what we're wanting to do is bring this back into children's lives. And the converse of that is this, now we'll get down to kind of articulating the parent voice. This is from a parenting magazine article, and the mom is talking about her own children. I want to stand in the front yard and sing out their lovely names at dusk and have them suddenly appear in the damp yard around me like little fireflies, but I can't let them roam. I don't have my mother's confidence that the world is a safe place. A certain sense of freedom and fun has gone out of the world. The golden age of childhood is gone. So I'm going to argue that the golden age of childhood isn't gone, but it's going. And it's our responsibility, both as parents and as educators, to not let the golden age of childhood go away. So I kind of think of us as like the audience watching Peter Pan when Tinkerbell has drunken the poison, right? And we have to all kind of clap and kind of believe in fairies in order to bring Tinkerbell back. So I think that's what we have to try and accomplish. So here's the reasons for this diminishing outdoor time: screen time, structured activities. You know, I know a lot of you are gonna feel a little guilty, you know. There's ballet lessons, there's soccer, there's swim lessons, right? There's fear of injuries. You know, we've decided that outdoor nature stuff like climbing trees is verboten. Right, and other kinds of outdoor recess. You know, some schools have outlawed running on their playgrounds. Tag is too dangerous. Those kinds of things. But we accept all kinds of other potential injuries from other things that have value. So what we've lost is this risk-benefit analysis mindset. So you allow your kids to play soccer even though it's dangerous. There's the possibility that something is, you know, they're going to get injured. Kids get injured playing soccer, but we accept the possibility of injury because we appreciate the benefits. So the benefits outweigh the risk. With a lot of outdoor activities for kids, like tree climbing, we've decided it's all risk and no benefit. Well, there's a lot of benefit in tree climbing. So we have this inappropriately applied risk anxiety about a lot of outdoor activities. And then there's the whole stranger danger thing as well. Even though kids are 1,600 times more likely to be injured in a car accident than abducted by a stranger. Right? The other statistics I really like, every 6 minutes in the United States, a kid is injured or entered into an emergency room at a hospital for an accident. Where in the house? You think you know the answer to this, but you don't. So where do you think it is in the house? In the bathroom, right. That's not it. It's on stairs, right? Stairs are the dangerous thing in the classroom, in the house, maybe even in schools. And you don't hear this big uproar about, oh, we should get rid of stairs, right? Right. The other thing is that 8,000 kids a year are injured because of falling flat screen televisions. So maybe it's a bit, maybe it's safer to have kids outdoors than indoors with all those flat screen televisions. So because of all that, we're seeing less of what's going on up there in the upper right hand corner and more of this. And yet, 94% of children want to spend more time outside. And 86% of parents say on a nice day, children would prefer to go to the park than watch TV. So kids want to be out there. Now, this is great. This is a portrait of four generations of range in one British family. And so range is basically how far your kids can go from home unsupervised on their own. Okay, so the great-grandfather in 1919 was allowed to walk 6 miles from his home down to go fishing down in the Rother Valley. So his range was, really big. The grandfather over here on the left, the circle, aged 8 in 1950, allowed to walk on his own into the woods about a mile. The mom, aged 8 in 1979, allowed to walk to the swimming pool about a half a mile away. And then the little dot up there on the upper left-hand corner, the son, Ed, now aged 8, allowed to walk on his own to the end of the street. Now, so a 90% reduction in range over the course of four generations. Roger Hart did a study of kids in Wilmington, Vermont, looked at them in the mid-1970s, and now just recently again, exactly the same thing has happened, but just over the course of 40 years. Wilmington, Vermont has not changed significantly in the last 40 years. There's not that much more traffic. There's not any greater rate of abductions. There's probably a few more ticks, but not that many actually in Wilmington. So this, functionally, the dangers to kids have not changed in the last 40 years. What's changed is parental attitudes. And essentially, people say that what's happened is that because we are saturated with media accounts of dangers to children, we've become hypervigilant. We have an exaggerated sense of fear in relationship to the actual fear that children are, the actual danger that children are subject to. So instead of the free exploration of the upper left-hand corner, we've got this down here, which is quickly becoming antiquated because soon every child will just have a chip embedded underneath their skin and you'll just track them on your cell phones, which, kind of is appealing, right? There's something, that's why we all have Facebook with older kids so we can track our children's activities, right? But we're losing that, right? And so this is an interesting development too. British Columbian Environmental Group flabbergasted that the Oxford Junior Dictionary is getting rid of words like beaver and dandelion and heron and magpie and otter. And in their place, they've replaced those terms with electronic BlackBerry blog, MP3 player, voicemail, and broadband. So the lexicon is changing. The body of language, the words that we use and that are commonplace are changing, and nature words are going away, and digital reality words are. And so when you know that when the lexicon changes, it's an indicator of cultural shift. And then we've kind of decided that searching on the computer has the same virtue as searching or hunting and gathering in the natural world. So let's take a look at, I'm going to just dive you right into an example of, so if we were to reverse the whole trend of of indoorification and digitalization in kids' lives, what would it look like? And so I'm going to show you an early childhood example. Later on, I'll show you an older kid's example. And this is from this wonderful movie called School's Out. We're just going to look at a 3-minute excerpt from it. This is from a Swiss forest kindergarten. In forest kindergartens, the kids are outside all day or whatever the length of the day program. This is basically an 8:30 to 1 o'clock kind of program. There is no indoors. There's a shelter in the woods, which you'll see a picture of. There isn't no indoors. Kids, so that the whole time that kids are in an early childhood program, basically a kindergarten program in this case, they're outdoors year-round. And so this is what it looks like.
Schneller, schneller, schneller! Komm, wir springen! Und dann plötzlich ist ein Hügel abgegangen.
Sonne ist verbracht, und wir manchmal spielen. Juhu! Da ist die Wald zu offen. Bis es auch zu heilen.
I just imagine what would happen with my kid in winter. Sometimes it can really snow here.
Work with knives and they cut on wood and makes me a little bit, I think it's a little bit scary, but
I spent the whole day with the kids and that was the time I saw the kids were even allowed to play with knives and swords, and at first I was shocked. I couldn't even move. In Africa, I don't think I'll trust my kid. I'll give my kid a knife.
Yeah!
I'm a teacher myself, and I've been in these regular school systems forever. My biggest fear is that the school, with the structure and the schedule and the appointments and the testing and the pressure, they're stopping the kids from actually becoming what they're meant to be. I found that the forest kindergarten is really, so far, the only place in regular school that I've come across where I think that's really a place where they still have this freedom.
So I would, on the Thatcher website, there's a claim that the school is really committed to joyful learning. And I would hazard to suggest that this is joyful learning. That these are, though I think the mom said, this is, you know, kids are getting to do what they're meant to do. And that there's a certain amount of joy, there's a certain amount of joyfulness in there. And there's a certain amount of letting kids be kids, right? There's also 20 problematic behaviors in that short 3-minute clip. And sometimes I kind of have a conversation just about the problematic behaviors. And it's not, they're not in there because they're mistakes or anything. It's part of what is allowed to happen there, you know. So all that sticks and stones play is something that forest kindergarten folks are saying, this is part of what childhood is. We gotta make it, We have to make it safe, but we're going to allow this to happen. So let's talk about place-based education. So if this is, kids are not having this, these opportunities to be out in the world on their own, you know, because they're going to swim lessons and because everything is programmed and because parents are afraid, then it becomes appropriate for schools and environmental educators and parents when they want to be activist parents, nature parents, to get kids engaged in the natural world through education programming. I like to talk about place-based education as opposed to environmental education because environmental education in the later part of the 20th century started to become tragedy education. Rainforest destruction or ozone hole or endangered species, and it lost its kind of connection with the joyfulness of learning. Environmental education started to mean too much about just natural sciences, and what we wanted to advocate was for kids engaged in the natural world and the cultural world, kids using social resources and cultural resources as part of education, that whole breaking down of the walls. So I'm going to give you some examples. Oh, there's a definition. I'm going to just let you read that. But I am going to highlight the second paragraph. That what we're talking about in terms of place-based education, which includes a big dose of nature, is that we want to increase academic achievement, help kids develop stronger ties to their communities, enhance their appreciation of the natural world, and have them develop a heightened commitment to being active citizens, right? So we're not sacrificing academics so that kids can play in the mud. We're about academic achievement and all these other things which schools have started to lose sight of. Dewey talked about schools as laboratories of democracy, and we've lost that in a lot of ways. So that this is this whole notion of developing active contributing citizens. And this notion that environmental commitment and social agency are going to happen because of firsthand experiences with real places. So all the stuff that's happening here in the 7th and 8th grade, where the kids are, you know, taking care of the chickens over at Wakefield Trust and you know, removing garlic mustard, those kinds of real experiences are the basis for environmental activism and environmental commitments. And that we ought to have a curriculum that reflects development. Some of the Montessori folks don't like this so much. is that if you look at kids, what kids mapped worlds are like from 5 through up through about 12, the real world for the young child is the home, and then it becomes the school, and then the neighborhood, and then the community, and then the watershed. And then the curriculum ought to follow that some. I'm going to give a good example. This is the example. I did a talk at a Montessori teacher conference, and they jumped on me for this. This is a friend of my daughter's in first and second grade at the elementary school right down the road from me. The teacher is a graduate from my teacher education program. And the first and second grade teacher is doing a unit on the solar system. And I say to her, I said, Emily, he said, you know that the solar system's not developmentally appropriate for first and second graders. I said, why are you teaching it? She said, it's in their curriculum, I have to teach it. So she teaches it in as charming a way as possible, in all those kind of child-centered ways. Songs and dance and mnemonic devices, you know, my very excellent mother just served us 9, some used to be pizzas. And that's the, you know, the order of the planets in the solar system. And so there's a little girl in the classroom named Linnea, a friend of my daughter's. Linnea loves the solar system unit. And she can name all the moons of Jupiter. I have the faintest idea. I think one of them might be Eos. But I don't know the names of the moons of Jupiter, nor am I sure that there's any reason why I should. But Linnea knows the names of the moons of Jupiter. She knows all the mnemonic devices, loves the solar system unit. I think maybe I'm wrong about this developmentally appropriate stuff. So we're going to the Caribbean with Linnea's family, my family, Linnea's family. We're on the plane. Linnea's sitting in the seat in front of me, next to her mom. She leans over to her mom and says, "Mommy, which planet is Mexico on?" Right? Which planet is Mexico on? Now, this is a good, this is my kind of synopsis of developmentally inappropriate education. If you teach, the kids can learn to regurgitate the content, the names, but they don't really have the classificatory understanding to understand that there's, you know, towns and then states and then countries and then hemispheres and then planets and then there's planets in the solar system and then a lot of solar systems in the galaxy. You know, they don't, that kind of learning, not really, that kind of classificatory thinking, not really appropriate. More appropriate in fourth, fifth, and sixth grade, not in first and second grade. So instead of the solar system, they should be studying the home, school, and neighborhood. What does that look like? So this is just another way to represent it. Home and school for 5 and 6 year olds, neighborhood for 7 and 8 year olds is kind of expanding worlds model. So this is what, here's a for instance of it in Malden, at the BB school, one of the magnet schools in Malden. You know, instead of those prefab alphabet cards around the outside of the classroom, you've got alphabet cards based on local field trips walking in the neighborhood in Malden. So one of these says, "My name is Patty, I'm a police officer. I work at the police station and I like pizza." That's the P card. So each one of the kids in the class made one of these after being on local walking field trips. Same kind of thing at a school in Bradford, Vermont, based on the town forest. And so all the A, B, C, D things are all things that you find in the town forest. Another example from Malden, more nature-based. We partnered the school and the Stone Zoo in Malden. And we had a zoo educator in the school halftime. And her role was to look for interconnections between the school curriculum and what the zoo needed. So there's bird curriculum in the first grade. They've got an eagle at the zoo. They'd like to have an eagle's nest adjacent to the eagle enclosure so that when parents come to the zoo with their kids, the kids can climb inside a life-size eagle's nest. So the first graders come to the zoo and build the life-size eagle's nest. So it makes for great curriculum, right? The kids really kind of grounded, you know, really understanding eagles and how big their nests are and how big the eggs are and how big the eaglets are. It's kind of a service learning, you know, because they're contributing to the zoo. And a great thing that happened in Malden was the zoo saw increased membership from parents in the community as a function of the school-zoo partnership. This is at the Young Achievers Math and Science Pilot School. Used to be in Jamaica Plains, now more in Mattapan. These kids come to Wakefield for some of their field trips. At this point, they were doing field trips out to Lincoln to go to the apple orchards and as part of their farm and food curriculum. And one of the things that happened was that they ran into the migrant farm workers at the orchard. And so the teacher said, "Well, you know, well, this is about farm and food, but it's also about social justice. So we're going to do a curriculum on migrant farm workers." And the kids wound up making posters, which you can't really see very well, that were about the issues that migrant farm workers faced. And the posters went into this local market. So kind of providing a service to the market in terms of shopper education. The next year, they said, "Well, it's kind of a pain to go all the way out to Lincoln. We're going to look for a farm facility more in inner city." And they found a homeless shelter that was about a mile from the school at that point. I'm not sure where it is now. And they were doing urban gardening and aquaculture. And so they were going there to kind of find out about farming and aquaculture practices, but then the kids started saying, "Well, why don't these kids have a home? Where do they live?" And so the teachers decided, "Oh, well, I guess we need to do a curriculum on homelessness." Is that you back there? Yeah, you're back there. Okay, this is all Bo Hoppen, teacher at at Young Achievers is responsible for a lot of this. So I said, I said to the teachers, homelessness, kind of heavy for first graders, right? They said, you know, we always have a homeless kid in this classroom. Anywhere we walk, there are homeless people on the street. So homelessness is not like a rainforest issue. It's an everyday issue. So we're gonna do a homelessness curriculum. And one of the things that came out of it was that the kids noticed that there were no picture books at the homeless shelter for the young children that were there. So they wound up doing a picture book drive and then they gave the picture books to the homeless shelter. So instead of the whole let's raise money to save the rainforest, which I'm a big believer in, right? But if we're going to cultivate social responsibility at an early age, doing something that kids can see the impact of in their own neighborhood makes a lot more sense. I'm still using this old data, Bo. Bo can give us an update on this. This was something we did now 10 years ago when we looked at, this place-based education, getting kids outside, kind of cute, but what about test scores? And so this was when we looked at a two-year group of kids that had been at Young Achievers for kindergarten and first grade, versus a one-year group, the kids had only been there for first grade, but they had been in kindergarten somewhere else. So all the kids that had kindergarten and first grade, but 2 years of that had been more a place-based approach with a lot of kind of nature education as part of it. And the kids in the darker purple there were scored higher on all the writing assessments than the other kids. This was another Malden example. Just another example of using a nearby resource. So this is a piece of town-owned land adjacent to the school butterflies curriculum in the second grade. The kids wound up creating a butterfly garden, and then all those graphics that are on those nice poster boards were kid-written and drawn graphics. I mostly like just the image in this. I love this kid nestled into this statue. Connecting kids to the natural world is important, but connecting them to their cultural heritage is just as important. And so there's this nice focus at Young Achievers on the intersection between place-based education and experiential education and social justice education. And so to show that how you can tie together being outside in the community and in the natural world with test scores, this was, for instance, where the teachers had determined that the kids didn't know how to read bar graphs and in the third grade. And so the teachers devised a project that had kids go to Felsmere Pond, about a 5 or 8 minute walk from the school, and interview local community members about different ways in which they use that park. Right? And then the kids had to create bar graphs that illustrated so many people sled, so many people make snowmen, and they did it through the year. So there was winter, spring, and fall activities. So they're tying together like, okay, we're paying attention to the test score stuff and we're engaging kids in the community. This is my kind of current fave school. This wonderful funky little school in Western Maryland, a very Appalachian community, high 70% free and reduced lunch. about 12 years ago, they're walking next to the school, and one of the kids says, "Why is this water orange?" And it turns out that the school's built right next to a coal tailings dump, and there was acid mine drainage through this area. So they worked with the Department of Natural Resources in Westford in Maryland, and they rehabbed the area next to the school so that it was, they remediated the acid mine drainage, and they turned it into an environmental education laboratory. And the teachers and the principals thought, hey, this is great. We like this environmental education, place-based education stuff. We want to do more of it. And so over the last decade, they have done more and more of this kind of place-based education. They've recently started installed a farm on the school grounds. And now all the different grade levels do different kinds of research that has to do with farm stuff. So it reminded me of the kids, the 7th and 8th graders working with Wakefield. So here one of the things, 2nd graders are trying to decide whether if there's a difference in weight between white eggs and brown eggs. And the 4th graders were doing a study on what happened if you added vegetables to the hens' diets, right, as opposed to just feeding them grain. In fact, what happens is that the egg productivity goes down, actually, they found out. And then kids doing this great feeder watch program in the 5th grade. In 2010, this school was the highest performing elementary school in Maryland. So of 874 elementary schools, Maryland State curriculum tests, they had the highest pass rate of any school in Maryland. Now think about Maryland, you know, there's Chevy Chase and Bethesda and Annapolis and all those kind of wealthy suburbs around the district. This school had the highest test scores. And I love the quote in the article from the Baltimore Sun. Right? School seems to be a model for how community can come together to see its children flourish. Far from teaching to the test, these top schools are succeeding because they're interested in the whole child. And a big part of what they've been doing here is all this is this place in nature-based education. Let me go, this is where I'm spending a lot of time right now, so I'm gonna indulge you in some of this research about early childhood. So we're going back to the forest kindergartens thing. Key features of forest kindergartens, and now what's happening is that the movement is going from forest kindergartens to forest schools. So we're doing some research on schools in Midland, Michigan, where there's a great nature preschool, and all the parents have loved the nature preschool, which is private, and then so the kids go to the public school and the teachers sit and the parents say, well, we want nature kindergartens. And so they've implemented nature kindergartens, and then the parents are saying, well, how about nature first grade? So this year they're actually doing nature first grades. And in Europe, the same thing's happening. There's this orientation towards expanding what has been an early childhood thing into the upper grades because parents recognize that kids are coming home happy and they're learning. So here's some of the parameters for forest kindergartens. Oh, that shouldn't be there. And that's the cover from the book. I showed this slide recently, and somebody from in the back, she said, I thought those were little ticks on her face. But that certainly is something you got to deal with when you're doing these outdoor programs. Now, they're little speckles of mud, but I think that her expression captures that kind of joyful learning notion. Here's an example of a program in Santa Barbara, early childhood nature-based program. And the kinds of curriculum that emerges when you have kids outside for 3 or 4 hours, you're looking into these little tree crevices. Of course, you eat outside, but then I love this. They found, this was the day I was there, one of the kids found this, which was a half-eaten pregnant lizard, right? So all those white things are the lizard eggs, right? And think of all the great content there is in that finding. You know, there's predation and reproduction and all those great and great things. And then, yes, you can sled in Santa Barbara. You sled on the oak leaves and and on the kind of the parched grass. So the Juniper Hill School in Maine is a forest school where, again, they're outside about half of the day. Got a skip some of these slides. Yeah, so this is part of what you're wanting when you're doing this this nature-based education with kids is this diverse forms of physical engagement with the landscape. So we've narrowed down the movement repertoire of a lot of kids from being full body movement to much more digitation. And even in sports, there's the kind of a limited repertoire. And what a lot of neurophysiologists say is what needs to happen in childhood is a wide range of different kinds of physical experience and coordination. So when you've got kids outside, you get interesting, diverse forms of kids using their bodies. There's been a lot of interest in advocacy and starting to be research now in whether this approach towards early childhood is going to be a useful obesity prevention technique. Same is going to be true up and through the elementary grades. In the video we saw, when the kids were rolling the ball down the hill, right? What they were trying to do is make the ball turn the corner. That's STEM learning, right? That's science, technology, engineering, and math. That's STEM learning in an outdoor setting. Same kind of thing here. The kids are having to figure out, okay, how do we make the seesaw operate? How do we make a seesaw, and then how do we make it operate? So understanding of levers and fulcrums. And then even in this school in Maine, there's the outdoors time, but then there's the regular literacy and math stuff indoors. So I want to illustrate this whole notion of play and learning, because we hear a lot about play as a children's work, but we don't really know what that means. And so this applies beyond the kindergarten. So it's from a wonderful paper called Crisis in the Kindergarten: Why Children Need to Play in School. And the contention is this is a continuum, and down at this end of the continuum you've got laissez-faire, loosely structured classrooms that tend towards being chaotic. On this end of the continuum, you've got didactic, highly structured classrooms where it's all teacher-led instruction. And the research suggests that neither end of the continuum is effective or most valuable. And that what you really need is to be in these two places in the middle, either the classroom rich in child-initiated play or the playful classroom with focused learning. And I want to show you a couple of examples of what this looks like in practice, where you're getting this kind of bridge between kind of joyfulness and wonder and real academic learning. So this is from a school in Richmond, Virginia, called the Sabbath School. And kids are out in the woods regularly. A lot of the schools that are trying to do this and implement it, you go to the same place once a week or twice a week all throughout the year. So there's a consistency. And then, the landscape starts to get named and different activities happen in different places. This activity was, there are two different things going on here. At this end of the log, there's mostly boys and they're doing deconstruction. They're basically trying to loosen the bowl, the trunk of the tree from the stump. They want to knock it off. This end of the log, kids are basically doing fabrication. There's a chocolate factory and a history museum going on. So kids' chocolate that's sawdust that's become really powdery, that's chocolate. And then they're finding little things in there and they're creating a little history museum. So self-initiated, playful, kind of chaotic learning. The two groups kind of operate in parallel fashion for a while until there starts to be some dissension. And the kids in the chocolate factory start to say they don't want the boys, to dislodge the trunk because they like walking up and down on the trunk and they think that their chocolate factory is going to be undermined or damaged if the tree falls down. So Stella says, people come down here just for a special tree. They like climbing on the tree. Luke, one of the deconstructors, says, well, you could always climb on other things, right? So there's a natural resource conflict here between how are we going to use the tree. The boys agree that if there's somebody walking on the tree or somebody on the tree, they will stop deconstruction activities. And so then Reese realizes that if he does a sit-in, then they can't ever deconstruct the tree, right? So the teachers wisely took this back into the classroom and used it as a conflict resolution activity. And so they had the kids articulate, so what are the reasons for why we should do deconstruction? Oliver said, persistence is good, like in the Iliad. Don't you want your preschool kids citing the Iliad, right? Drew says, it's going to be fun to watch when it drops. It's going to make a big cloud of dirt. The other kids are saying, leave nature alone. It'll squish us when it falls. You know, it's part of the forest and animal habitat. So look at what this is. Look at what's happening here. So one of the common core key points in writing is the ability to write logical arguments based on substantive claims, sound reasoning, and relevant evidence. So these kids are learning to take a stand and argue for what they believe in. They're using literature and history to support their arguments, like in the Iliad. They're recruiting others to help support their positions, right? So there was, the kids would say, Sally, come and say what you said about why they shouldn't do it. So they're building coalitions. And they're recognizing that nonviolent action might be a method for making a point. So what's happened is we've gone from the self-initiated playful activity to, which is on one end of the continuum, to someplace that's more in the middle, where it's the child-initiated play has turned into valuable academic kind of learning. This is back at that school in Maine, where it's fascinating to see the same things emerging in different places. Also doing a chocolate activity, same material, right? And the kids, these kids created a bakery, and they had, they were making nut bread and chocolate pudding and cakes and all this kind of stuff using, sawdust and sleet and mud. And then the teachers had them actually write down their recipes for the different concoctions. And they had this whole bakery laid out. There was a big downed tree and all the things were on it. They had a little cabinet with cupcakes in it. And coal was the currency because there was a little coal dump nearby. So coal was what you used to buy stuff. So then the teacher worked with a local tea house. And the woman was a baker. And the baker created recipes that were parallel to the recipes the kids had made. So there's this nut bread recipe that had wood chips and mud and sawdust in it. She created a recipe for nut bread, and the kid who created this actually went to the bakery and baked real edible stuff and then had a tea party for their parents, right? And so they had to be able to read and translate these recipes, actually follow the instructions, and then I'm not going to read all those different things. But so the kids, so it went again from playful messing about in the mud kitchen to creating a real tea for their parents with lots of literacy and math involved. So both the natural world joy and then the academic learning. Oops. I love this one too. You might want to do this if you're kind of involved with a lot of chickens. This is a school in St. Paul where they showed up and they had a playground chicken, and the chicken had been dispatched by a fox, I think. And so the teachers realized that that they needed to use this opportunity as an opportunity to do, celebrate the life of the chicken. So there's the chicken is in the box right there. And they had the kids all write words of passing and tribute to Lori on rocks. Sometimes the kids dictated their messages and the teachers wrote them. And then at the burial site, the children stroke Lori, and then there's this spontaneous song that emerges that one of the kids just kind of started to sing. So this is more of a teacher-directed activity, but recognizes the kids' need, recognizes and honors children's relationships with animals and what and how the passing of the chicken should be acknowledged and used as a way to kind of get, you know, teach kids lessons about the natural world. So what we've done here, and a lot of these, is move from the laissez-faire into the middle here. Public schools in Vermont are doing this Forest Fridays or Forest Mondays, one day a week outside most of the day, year round. If you did this last year, then you can do it any year. Because it wasn't quite as snowy in Vermont as it was here, but it was pretty snowy and it was pretty cold. And there's now this kind of little, this grassroots movement to create these kind of opportunities in public schools around Vermont. Here's what, in some evaluation of these programs, one parent says, we've noticed that she, their daughter in one of these programs, become increasingly more responsible at home, taking it upon herself to do jobs. She's more confident knowing she can take initiative instead of waiting to be asked. I really wish the schools would add forest curriculum to the upper grades. So then what's it look like in sixth grade? So this is some pictures from, some images from my wife's classroom. I was talking a lot about these forest kindergartens. She said, well, I'm gonna do this with my sixth graders. She said, in the beginning, I thought it was gonna be, she just did it, this is the second year she's doing it. She did it last year. Last year I thought it was gonna be science outdoors. We were gonna measure the stream, the flow rate in the stream, and we were gonna identify trees and things. She said, and what kids really needed and wanted was to do basically kind of neo-tribalism, right? Right? Is that they wanted to build forts, make fires, make tools, you know, track animals. And so, you know, this is them in the woods. She also had 7 or 8 kids on IEPs. She said it was the most bonkers group of kids she ever had. She said some of these kids were only kind of engaged in school on this day. So they did a lot of, you know, this is, you know, what you would normally do in camp, in good old time summer camps, right? Face painting. They did a lot of cooking over the fire. They made crowns and they also did burial rituals. You know, they did it all year round. They also went ice fishing because there was a dad who was an ice fisherman, so they went ice fishing one of the days instead of going out into the woods. They did snow sculpture, and so each of the groups had become a clan, and so you had a clan animal, right? And so then each of the clans had to make a snow sculpture of their clan animal. So that's the coyote down there. I think this was the moose, not quite as articulated. She was, this last year, if you looked at the kids' math test scores over the last 4 years, this group of kids' math scores had been kind of intransigent. They had been, you know, 30% of the kids proficient in third grade, 35% in fourth grade, 26% in fifth grade, 71% in sixth grade. They weren't sacrificing their academics by having the kids outside. In fact, the energy and the joy and the investment of being able to be outside and doing stuff that was inherent kid stuff, even for sixth graders, was the engine for having them be more engaged in school. That was a slide that went with the previous. This is just another, for instance, going back to the Forest Kindergarten in Queechy, Vermont. This is another parent comment. Program is probably the best educational thing that's happened to my kids. He gets all the standard kindergarten education, but he also gets a lot more than that. And this is just the little ending. I think this is it. This is just the little ending marketing thing. So this is a new program that we've got at Antioch New England in nature-based early childhood. We're running a lot of conferences, and we've got courses for folks that are interested in this kind of approach. We also do a lot of education, nature-based education, place-based education for elementary age teachers as well. So the big idea, actually I'll end with this, the quote that I was going to end with. This is a quote from my daughter to kind of about, and this is really a kind of cultivating the wonder of nature quote. This is my daughter wrote this when she was about 20 years old as a Christmas letter to her mom and I. And what you have to know is that I tried to parent my kids in all these ways, right? This kind of, that kind of neo-tribalism way in terms of forts and dens. And a lot of what people would consider inappropriate magical thinking, you know, fairies and fancifulness and animals turning into people and people turning into animals and all that kind of stuff. So she said, "Dear parents, I often ponder what it has been in my life that's made me the person I am. I ask this question for several reasons. I'm always searching for the roots of happiness. What plants this seed? What gives it the light and the water it needs to flourish? What natures it? I'm my own case study, and I'm curious about the variables. The other reason is that I want to understand how to raise my children so they can appreciate the world the way I do. When I think about my childhood, I'm flooded with so many delightful memories. The little treasures that you filled my days with have remained with me, tinkling in my thoughts like a chandelier. So much of what has shaped my awe and appreciation of the world was the magic that was always present. I remember once asking about where fruits and berries came from, and you told me, Mommy, that all I had to do was draw a picture and leave it outside overnight, and the fairies would exchange it. Sure enough, when I went to check on my little two-dimensional paper cutouts, they had been replaced by real fruits and berries." This was when the kid, when they got a little older, they started to started to be suspicious about this. This is kind of like when kids start to do tests on Santa Claus, you know. They got suspicious about this whole thing, about whether, oh, I don't think this is, you know, the fairies are really doing this. So they said that they left the little paper cutouts out there, and they didn't tell us. And then I found out years later that something was there the next day that we hadn't had anything to do with. So then I started to believe in magic, right? So the paper cutouts replaced by fruits and berries. This was one of the visits from the fairies whose presence in my youth instilled in me an appreciation for myth and wonder and an ongoing belief in the magical. This real life magic was embellished by your decadent storytelling, Daddy. The ongoing epic of Princess Quartz and the corresponding outdoor adventures have taught me to truly adore the natural world and see the characters and personalities of rocks and plants and landscapes. This connection to the earth, which is everywhere and always nurturing, is one of the greatest gifts I've ever received. It allows me to feel at home anywhere, that I can plant my feet in the soil and hug the trees, and it helps me to find peace and solitude within myself and the world around me. So, you know, this was one of those unsolicited, kind of makes parenting, makes all those years worth it, like when you get a letter like this. But what she's really articulating is this notion that, you know, if we can cultivate this relationship with the natural world, it has great, you know, it gives kids a sense of inner resourcefulness and a sense of self and a sense of commitment to protecting the world. And so if we start in that kind of joy and wonder, it can develop into kind of adult integrity. So thanks.